very much and thank you, Rohini, and a little bit of latitude to 40-45 minutes would be grateful. We've been working on water for many years, as you know, at CSC, and recently we got very increasingly aware of the fact that India was getting into a difficult situation. We were beginning to see conflicts happen across the country between water users, existing water users, which is cities, agriculture and cities. And we also began to understand that India really does not know enough about the water use and for growth. That when India is industrializing, urbanizing, we are not thinking about the fact that that urbanization model is going to also demand a huge amount of water. And that India cannot afford the transition, the water transition of the rest of the world. If you look at this, it makes it very clear that in European countries at least, I wouldn't extrapolate this for the US, but definitely in Europe, large parts of the water is used in urban industrial areas, very little in agriculture. The reverse is true in India. But what is important to understand is that there is a transition happening. There is a growth story happening. We hear about the Planning Commission, the Prime Minister, everybody talking about the economic growth story of India. They never talk about the cost of water in that growth story. The fact is that as we will industrialize, as we will urbanize, we will require more and more water. There is a water footprint to cities. There is a water footprint to industries. But the fact is that where the rest of the world, or particularly large parts of Europe, have been able to move water to industries and to urban areas, it is also because people and economy has moved to urban and industrial. Very little of the rich world's economy comes out of agriculture. There is very little employment generated from agriculture. But the reverse is true in India. We will remain an agriculture-dependent economy for years to come. Not an economy, but certainly livelihoods will come out of agriculture. Certainly a large amount of employment will come out of agriculture. Even by 2050, the census says, the predictions are that we will remain a rural country and only 50% of India will be urbanized. Which means that there will be increasing tensions between the existing users of water and the growing users of water. And it is this tension that we are beginning to see across the country. It's also important because when I look at simple economic figures, ADB recently came up with a report in which when you look at the economic value that water provides, it's very easy to argue that you need to provide that water to industry and to cities for the simple reason that you get $4 of GDP growth for $1 of investment. Whereas in agriculture, the agreement, the assumption is that you get $1. So you will get increasing amount of pull to get that water, the water investment that is made, to push it to industry, which is going to lead to tensions. But as your water researchers here, I want to make the point that do not say anything in India about water with any sense of confidence, please. Because when I start looking at where the data comes from, there is no data. Everybody says 80% of water use is in agriculture. Yet where does the data for that come from? The last analysis that was done, as all of you know, was done in 1999. And then you will ask Dr. Ramaswamy Iyer, who was the secretary at that time and in charge of this analysis, he will tell you it was a back of the envelope calculation, in which they estimated that water use in industry will grow and urban areas will grow, but not to have any significant change in the water balance and the water budget of the country. Now that is completely, if you look at it today and you look at what's happening, that to my mind is not going to be. So their prediction was that in 2025, 73% 50% of the water would still be used in irrigation. And that urban industry, urbanization, which is domestic and industry, would use very little. But our own analysis, which is something that we did for just a few sectors in India, we looked at paper, power, fertilizer, aluminium, and what shocked us was to see the water footprint of all these sectors. And it is very clear that even if we bring the best technology, power, for instance, is moving towards a waterproofing technology, even then, the scale, the sheer scale of the development, the sheer scale of the projects that are going to come up, you're going to have huge water use. And so I think this is something that needs to be investigated, needs to be researched on. We need much more accurate ideas of what is going to be the water use in industries. Because if we don't, we will begin to see more and more conflict. We will begin to see more and more conflict over the allocation of water between the existing users and the new users. Joy is here. They have been documenting this across the country. And if they were to and I believe this issue is only going to grow further. Because this is going to be one of the key issues for the future. Which really brings me to the challenge we have. And I really strongly believe that this is the challenge for water planners, for urban planners to think about for the future. Is that India has to grow, we will urbanize, we will industrialize. But how do we industrialize and urbanize without water? How do we make a water-prudent society? How do we make sure that we urbanize, but without using huge amounts of water and then creating huge amounts of waste? And that really, to me, is a very important challenge, because it will be a challenge which will also determine the future of rural water use and also water security. So this is what we did. We produced a book. We did a book where I think the most fascinating part of our work was, and I wish I could show it to you, but I'm unfortunately a Mac user, so I knew that I'd never be able to configure it here. I wanted to show you our data sheets that we collected for 71 cities. We collected data sheets of water use in the cities, of how much water is wasted, how much waste is generated, how much groundwater is used by official estimates, how much groundwater is used by our estimates. So we have 71 data, we have a data sheet on 71 cities. And we're just working to put that out, because I think that is very important for water researchers to now play with that data and build a much more credible story of what's happening in India, and particularly its urban areas. But the second part of our book is a 71 city analysis. We've done city by city. And each city that you read, you will find the question that we have asked is, where does the water come from? Where does the waste go? And it is appalling to see the lack of understanding, particularly about the waste of a city. Nobody knows. And because it's all truncated between the water supply and the pollution control department, nobody cares either. So it's a very important area, in my view, to look at from a research point of view. But what did we find? Anything? More briefly, but what did we find? One, that water in our cities, there is enough water to supply. But what, and planners are always obsessed with supply or with augmentation, with water, but not with supply. And the reason is that we are getting into a paradigm of water supply in which planners actually cannot ever supply water to the people that they have got water for. The reason is, we get water from further and further away. This leads to higher costs of supply. It leads to very high distribution losses. And so there is less water at the end of the pipeline to supply. Whatever the less water is, that then costs a lot more for its supply. And in all that, cities are never have enough money to spend on refurbishment of the existing water supply system, but they absolutely have no money to spend on the waste management system that they need, because as much water you supply, as much waste you get back. And so I said, as I said, there is enough water, but water does not reach all. And in that, one of the major areas of research in my view is to look at intra-city inequity. Because this is huge. And you must understand that this is not about the sheer incompetence of our water utilities. It is also to do with the very technology that they have adopted, the systems that they have adopted for supply. Because, as I said, they do not have enough money to be able to extend the pipeline to everyone. Their entire effort is in bringing the water and from longer and longer distances. So there is enough per capita supply. Most of the cities that we tracked have above per capita LPC, on an LPCD basis, and there is benchmark set by the government of India at 150 for a metro city, 135 for a metro city, which for other cities which have a sewage system, but all that is very vague. I mean, frankly, nobody knows how much water they're supposed to supply. But by any parameter you take, there was enough water for supply. But what was very interesting was that the water highway, as I call it, leaks at both ends. So what, if you want to talk about this to most water experts, and particularly people who look at it from an infrastructure point of view, they're very excited by these findings. They always say, yeah, there are lots of distribution losses. We have to fix the distribution losses, and once we can fix the distribution losses, everything will be okay. But they never talk about the fact that the leakage is on both sides. The fact is that not only is there a leakage in bringing the water to the city, but because the city supplies in unequal measures within the city itself, it ends up supplying a lot to some and very little to others. So there is no shortage of water for some, for a certain group of people in cities. If you look at this, and I'll explain it through this chart over here, look at Mumbai. The total supply is 3,000 million liters. The actual supply after leakage loss is about 2,000 million liters. 1,000 million liters is lost in distribution. The actual supply in the non-slum areas, because there is large areas of Mumbai which are slum areas, and nobody can tell me that they can supply 135 LPCD to a slum area, because that would require each individual in a slum to collect 135 buckets of water every day. Each bucket of water is 10 liters. So just think about it. Which means that we took what would be normally supplied, 35, we then calculated how much would be the supply in the non-slum area. So that goes up to 1,854. If you look at it on a per capita basis, the same figures, the overall supply, including leakage loss, was 235. So that is the total supply, well above what Bombay should actually be supplying. Bombay should be supplying, Mumbai should be supplying 150 LPCD. Actually supplied 235, way above its quota. Ending up, because of leakage, with only 165 LPCD. But then in the non-slum areas, it supplied 300 LPCD. Now these figures are very important for us to understand, because if we don't understand them, we really don't know where policy is going. Policy will keep fixing and looking at augmentation and saying we need more water, not realizing that it's really about how we will supply within the city. In my own city of Delhi, they are even franker about it. The Delhi government officially admits the fact that it has intra-city inequity. We looked at their calculation of how much water supply to different regions, put together this map, and if you look at it, what I call the Lutyen Delhi, Luton's Delhi, but I prefer the term Lutyen Delhi, NDMC area gets 462 liters per capita per day. But there are parts of Delhi that get only 30 liters per capita per day officially. Now the reason is Delhi sources its water at north at that point in Wazirabad, and the pipelines have to pump and pipe water across the length and breadth of a growing city. And as a result of it, you get this huge picture of intra-city iniquity. You also get the fact that cities spend all that they have in just supplying and fixing the problems. And so it's very important for all of us to also start talking about the fact that when we talk about distribution losses, it's not just about inefficiency. It's also about the nature of the supply system that we have adopted. And the nature of the supply system is that we bring water now from further and further away, which leads to high transmission losses, high cost of energy, and then high spending in the operation and maintenance and the cost of repair. But the problem is, and if you look at all project proposals of the JNURL in the first phase, all money went in augmentation. All money went in bringing water to the cities, even if it meant building 500 kilometers of pipeline, building a dam, bringing the water to the city. So the entire focus is to bring water without thinking about the nature of the problem. You can't read this, I don't want you to read this, I just want you to understand that this is part of what we have to do. What we did here was to look at every city, we looked at where their past sources of water were, we looked at their present sources of water, and then we looked at their future sources of water. And if you start looking at that, you build this huge map of India where every city is having to bring water is getting longer and longer. It's bringing it from further and further. So if you look at Bangalore there, or if you look at Chennai there, Chennai is bringing it now from Vietnam, or Hyderabad, or Indore, or any one of the cities. And this is part of the water crisis in our cities. The only city that I could find which actually keeps what I call water accounts was Nagpur, which sources 765 MLD, ends up with only 200 MLD. Maximum loss is in bringing the water to the city. And remember, it brings it from a tiger reserve or a bench. And as a result of it, the water highway has losses, it has costs, which we cannot pay for. Every city reports officially 50% losses, which adds to costs. What cities do not report very easily is the cost of energy in the supply of water. And yet, if you look at the balance sheet we did, we found, after a lot of effort, we found accounts of different city utilities, and you will find that the brown is in each case growing. Most cities spend all the money that they have on just pumping the water and supplying it. And in all this, as I said, water doesn't reach everybody. And as water doesn't reach everybody, they have no option but to depend on groundwater. But when we ask cities how much groundwater dependence there is, all cities without fail said negligible. Because they do not account for groundwater use unless it is officially tapped and officially supplied. And so there is a huge growth of groundwater, which we all know from private wells, tanker mafia, bottled water. The last NSS survey for the first time actually recorded how much bottled water is used in cities. And it's becoming bigger and bigger. And as we don't recognize this water source, we don't have any respect for its management. But what we did in Delhi was just, and it's something that can be easily done for across India. If you were to superimpose the map that you have of water inequity, where the pipeline doesn't reach, and look at it from a point of view of groundwater, and just take the groundwater map of a city, superimpose it on it, you will find that you understand both inequity, because where the water does not reach, the groundwater levels are plummeting, and you also understand the groundwater economy, because where the groundwater is plummeting, you know that people have no option but to use it. So this is something that I believe can be done for cities and for us to understand what is happening. But because we do not respect groundwater, we also do not ever respect the recharge systems that are needed to keep groundwater going in our cities. So our lakes get abused, At most, lakes have been seen as pretty recreation things for most cities. But most city water planner accounts for the health of a lake from a point of view of the recharge that it provides for its critical water supply system, which is groundwater. So there is a huge missing gap in understanding. And as a result of it today, land is valued, water is not. There is absolutely no legal protection for city lakes, for the catchments and the drainage systems. The only city where I found a law to protect the catchment tied to the lake was Guwahati, which has an actual law for it, but it is very difficult for it to implement. And as a result of it, the sponges are being destroyed. Ahmedabad has a fascinating case where IIM, in fact, fought to shut, because IIM did not want that high court case because it was building on top of a lake catchment. Hyderabad has built his airport on the catchment of its Himayat Sagar, and Bangalore, Rohini city, has a beautiful, intricate system of lakes which would have provided it the most vibrant groundwater economy and provided it a decentralized water system, but it doesn't respect it. Instead, it wants to bring its water from Kaveri, where it spends 40 rupees per kiloliter just to pump it to the city. And this has major implications for the future, because lakes, at the end of the day, are going to be the protection of a city in the age of climate change. The one thing we know about climate change is that it is going to lead to more extreme weather events. It is going to lead to more intense rainfall events. It is the Pune Institute, IITM, has put out more and more evidence to show us that in India, the amount of rain is increasing, but the number of rainy days are decreasing. Which means that if a city needs to survive every rain for it not to become an urban flood, an urban nightmare, then it has to protect its sponges. It has to protect its lakes. But if that is never factored into the beginning of the city's water supply, be very clear, it will never happen. And what was appalling for us is the fact that how little we understand about groundwater. There are 40 cities where measurement happens with 2 observation wells in each city. It's completely inadequate. And yet we know from whatever we get is that levels are falling, and more than that, nitrate levels in groundwater are increasing, which means a clear case of sewage contamination. And that brings me to my favorite subject, waste. Cities at the end plan for water, never for waste. And yet 80% of the water which reaches our house, 80% of that leaves it as sewage. So the more water we use, the more waste we have. And in all the cities that we looked at, 71 cities, not a single city could account for how much waste it was generating and where the waste was going. Not a single city keeps separate accounts for what it spends on the sewage system refurbishment. So there is absolutely no clue of what I call the shit maths of this country. And the excreta maths of this country officially are also very grim. We officially, and this is official CPCB data, this is the only data that exists in India, we officially discharge 80% of the urban sewage as untreated and dispose it in our rivers, lakes and groundwater. So officially 78% is actually untreated. So we flush, we forget. But more than that, when you start looking at excreta maths even more carefully, you find that Delhi and Mumbai, of the sewage treatment capacity which we have, the capacity to treat 11,788 MLD, of that, 40% exists in just 2 cities of Mumbai and Delhi. So you have to understand the nature of the challenge. But before any of you jump up and say, this is the infrastructure challenge of India, please understand that this is exactly the problem. We plan for sewage in the way that the rest of the world has planned for it by building sewage treatment plants. We believe that is where the answers for sewage treatment will lie. But we forget the fact that there are large parts of our cities which are unconnected to an underground sewage network. And so at the end of the day, we can build a sewage treatment plant, but we do not have the capacity to be able to convey the waste to the sewage treatment plant. And yet, every time I say this, I find there is blank. There's a blank look on the face of everyone who says, well, what's the problem? The problem is we just build, forgetting the nature of the challenge. We do not even know the fact that what are toilets all about. If you look at all the LSS surveys, we took a look at the 54th round, the 58th, the 65th, and then the 85th, the health survey that is done. And what is fascinating to know is that most of our statisticians can't differentiate between the toilet seat and the conveyance system. So we do not know whether the toilet, which we say is a poor flush toilet, is it connected to a septic tank or is it connected to an underground sewage network. The first time we spoke to the census when this was happening, and the first time we had data on toilets and connections, and what we find out is that even though 72%, this is only for urban India, only urban India data, 72% is connected to what they say is a flush in a port latrine system, only 32% is connected to a piped sewer network. The rest of it, they say, is septic systems. But we know as cities are getting more dense, septic systems are getting to be a really big challenge because it's difficult to maintain them. But more than that, our own survey found that cities do not have drains. So there are new growth cities that are growing without drains, and there is a backlog and there is a front log. If you look at this list of cities, you will find that the only cities that claim that they have over 70% underground sewage are Chennai, Pune, Surat and Gurgaon. And as far as Gurgaon is concerned, it's complete rubbish, because the only part of Gurgaon which is sewer, which they say is sewer, is municipal Gurgaon, which is now that means nothing, because the growth of Gurgaon is outside municipal Gurgaon, where there is no sewerage network. And if you look at the other cities, Delhi will fall into 50, most other big cities will fall into 50%. So you have to understand the nature of the crisis. We have, our city of Delhi, for instance, already does not have sewerage network. We now have to build more. And as a result of it, where there is a sewage treatment plant, there is no sewage network to bring sewage to it. And where there is sewage, there is no sewage treatment plant. If you look at Bangalore, my favorite example, Rohini, because just for the sheer, it tells me the scale of the challenge. Bangalore is my favorite city only because when I talk to the water utility managers there, they're always very, very up with everything. They know everything. And they don't have the confidence of saying, these guys are really good. They are at the forefront of the challenge. And they came to me and I said, how many sewage treatment plants do you have? And they said, seven. They said, there are 14 sewage treatment plants. I said, what technologies? And they said, every technology, madam, every technology under the sun, we have it. Come to Bangalore and see the fact that we have every technology that can be used. It's actually a high-tech city. So, it's very proud of the fact that they have every technology. Then I made the mistake of asking, so how much of that capacity is utilized? And that's when there was pin drop silence. Because of the fact of the matter is that Bangalore has the capacity to treat all the sewage it generates. But even Bangalore treats only 300 MLD of the 781 MLD that it has created. Because the rest of it, it just does not even have the pipes to bring it to it. And now it plans to build 4,000 more kilometers of underground sewage network. And remember, in the 100 years of Bangalore, they have built 3,610. They need to build 4,000 for today. And they are saying for the growth that is happening, they need to build another 4,000 by tomorrow. And as you build, the old needs repair. And in this way, we are constantly catching up, but we never catch up. And the tragedy of this, the tragedy that we need to worry about is that this partial treatment, this capital intensive way of treating your sewage means that some part of the sewage is treated, a majority of sewage is never treated, and the end result is pollution. So if this country wants to have its rivers flow once again, the fundamental thing that we have to understand is inequity in supply, inequity in service will lead to unsustainability. Equity becomes then the bottom line of sustainable urban growth. If you cannot provide sewage to all, you cannot take back the waste of all, you cannot treat the waste of all, you will never be able to clean your rivers. I will not get into this. I can get really obsessive about Delhi and Chennai and the complete mindlessness of the systems that they have for treating their waste. But take it from me, this system is completely broken because we are following what we believe is the only way to treat sewage, to build sewage treatment plants, to pump it to it, to treat it, and then we not think about where we can dispose it. But we forget the fact that we all live downstream. Every one of us is affected in this. The most stark example of living downstream is the city of Agra, which is building a new water treatment plant. And the water treatment plant will cost Agra the equivalent of what a sewage treatment plant costs a city. A sewage treatment plant is about a crore, a million liters. A water treatment plant is about 25 lakh, a million liters. Agra will have to build a water treatment plant which is equivalent to a sewage treatment plant, because the water it is getting in Yamuna, being downstream of Delhi, being downstream of Mathura, the water it is getting is actually sewage. It is shit and urine of the cities upstream. So it's very important for us to understand this, simply because remember, if every city has to put in the Agra type water treatment plant, then go back to the maths I gave you. The cost of water supply will even go up further. Right now, cities don't spend on water treatment. They only supply in sourcing, pumping, and supply. And as a result of it, we are literally a generation of lost rivers. I mean, you know, when I was doing this book, this is the one thing that really hit me, was how many cities, how many rivers have actually got lost. Najafgarh was a river, and yet I, in my own city, and I come from Old Delhi, I know Najafgarh only as a drain, and as a really dirty drain that brings water to Yamuna. And yet, it was the Sarayu River which flew from the Aravallis, which came from the Aravallis. Mithi in Mumbai is officially called a drain. And yet, just about 70 years ago, it was a free-flowing river. Ludhiana knows its river as the Buddha Nala. And yet, there is evidence in Ludhiana, recent enough, where people remember that it was called a darya. It was a river with water. And the question therefore I ask always is, in this system of a capital intensive water supply, inequity in supply, a lack of ability to collect the waste, are we not reaching the point where every one of our rivers will become a drain? And that tomorrow we will even call Ganga a drain. And in all this, one of the things that I am always confronted with is that people say, well, this is just temporary. We will build our infrastructure. There's a recent report by Dr. Isharan Walia, which puts a very huge figure on the urban infrastructure cost. And there's a general assumption that there will be private money that comes in and that everything will be okay. and that the only bottom line that is stopping anything is the fact that water tariffs are very low. It's a very simple assumption. It's like what Tushar and I have had a lot of battles over, and I have often argued with him, this assumption that farmers don't pay the price of energy and so they are over pumping and so groundwater is going down. It's an assumption. The fact is people actually pay for water in this country. Water tariffs are high in many cases. Tariffs are high, but recovery is poor because meters don't work. And the poor always end up paying more than the rich for water, and they pay more than that with bad water with their health. But where tariffs are high, people move to groundwater, and so cities then find they're not even able to recover what the little they were recovering in the past. And in all these sums, we have never really estimated, if we were to account for sewage costs, what would be the cost of the system. Not going to get into this, but just to say we collected data on cities on their water tariff, and it is not low. We also found that there was a huge cross-subsidization happening between domestic water and in commercial water. But what we find is that in the case of Bangalore, for instance, which is a very stark case, as the tariff for industrial water is raised, industries move to groundwater. And so you are finding unsustainability of groundwater grows, and the city then has an additional problem of sewage and effluents that leave the industry. We're also finding that under-recovery is growing. This is between the revenue that a city utility collects and what it actually spends. And this is where the city utility is not even spending on sewage. And we also found that you need very high investment in sewage, and that nobody in this country really has put together what it costs to build a sewage network. I have seen various figures in all documents, everything from 1 crore to 3 crore for a million liters of sewage treatment capacity. But nobody tells you what is the actual cost. So huge gray area there of what will it actually cost to take back the sewage and treat it. And yet we are spending all our time fighting over this ridiculous issue of private versus public. The fact is that the current contracts are about public investment and private profit. There is no question about that. So this is what even in my, so it is a PIPP. But the fact also is that experience is very limited. That the 24/7 buzzword that we talk about is operating in two wards of Hubli and Dharwad, and there is not enough evidence that we have collected today that it will actually reduce losses on a city-wide basis. We do not know enough, and yet we are spending our time either giving up contracts or just arguing about them. And the fact is that the one demand we should be making is that even if you do PPP, they have to include sewage. And once they begin to include sewage, you will find that no PPP becomes viable. Because you take the profit of water, the loss always is in the waste. So the reform agenda, very quickly, is one, cut the cost of water supply. If you want to supply to all and not some, then you have to begin to cut the costs of water supply, which means that you have to start sourcing locally. You have to reduce the losses of distribution. And so cities have to legislate to protect local water bodies. Two, you need to focus on demand side, which means that you, instead of making cities believe that they need to increase their per capita water supply, every city must give maps of how they have reduced intra-city inequity, how they have reduced wastage, and how they have been able to build a water-prudent city for the future. Third, plan for sewage deliberately. One of my demands to the government has been that no water supply scheme can be passed without the design for sewage. You cannot fund water without planning for sewage. And once you start planning it, you will look at the cost of sewage, and that will force you to reevaluate the technology and the design to look for more affordable solutions. But that the bottom line is, we have to plan differently for sewage. If we plan the same sewage treatment plants, pump, pipe, take, clean, we'll never get there. Finish it. We have to plan very differently. We have to plan for sewage today, not think of cities when they will get underground sewage networks. So you can actually plan for open drains to be sewage treatment zones. You could use your lakes and ponds as treatment zones. You could treat locally so that you could put the treated water into local systems for reuse. So you need to think completely out of the box when you think of sewage. And in that, the most important challenge then is to redesign the flush system. Because the flush system today has been designed to take a little bit of human excreta, use water to flush it, to carry it, and to dispose it. And this basically is making it so that you also take the nitrogen-phosphorus cycle and disrupt it completely. I am a member of something very bizarre, which is the Amarnath Triangle, which is interesting for the only reason that we did micro-treatment at very high altitude to treat the waste of pilgrims. And it's fascinating for me because as you know, it's very dramatic, it's got a lot of Hindu-Muslim issues, but forget all that. The fact is that you had to treat the waste of pilgrims in a very short period in a very cold environment. And in this case, the boat contracted it out to someone who used microbes for treatment and actually treated the waste to near drinking water, not near 15 BOD, but very clean, and returned it back to the hydrological cycle. You also have to plan deliberately for reuse. Every drop of water must be reused. And that is where I believe the answer, which a lot of you are working on, fits into this puzzle. Because the fact is, when I talk about reuse, and we have, you'll see every engineer comes up with a plan for tertiary treatment of water. Look, Bangalore has the most bizarre tertiary treatment in Kupon Park, just finishing ruining, Kupon Park, where it treats to tertiary level to put back into gardening. Only a rich city like Bangalore can do something so stupid. The fact of the matter is that if you treat water to tertiary level, you put it back into drinking water. You then reuse it for drinking. Otherwise, you treat it to secondary level, put it back in the lake in the pond so that becomes your tertiary treatment ground, or you reuse it for agriculture. That is what Kolkata did in its wetlands. That is what Musi is doing. We just have to get it right. But we have to make it part of the city water waste maths. And the last point I want to make, particularly to all of you, is that please start planning with knowledge. I am so frustrated at the lack of rigor in doing the estimations for water use in this country. As I said, the last assessment was done in 1999. If I ask what is the water supply, no city knows how much water it supplies. It simply takes its population, which it doesn't know, with the LPCD, which it assumes, and multiplies it and comes up with a figure. There is no estimation which is better. Nobody can tell you that they've actually supplied this amount of water. But then when you ask them how much waste is generated, they make an additional simple calculation. They take the water that they supplied and they multiply it by 0.8. 80% leaves, they say. But they don't know how much water they supply, they don't know how much groundwater is used, so they don't know how much waste leaves. And yet, that's how we plan our sewage treatment systems in this country. So we have to get our water maths, our estimation done with a lot more rigor. We cannot afford this kind of back of the envelope, you know, ridiculous calculation. And so at the end, excreta does matter. It's about affordable urban growth, it's about inclusive urban growth, it's about sustainable urban growth. You don't get that right, you're in real deep shit. Thank you very much.